All right, so I need a minimum effort video today because I'm about to run out of deer season. I got two more days to hunt and I haven't got one yet. I've been chasing this 10 point I saw right before season came in and having no luck at that. So I've switched over to meat in the freezer mode. So I need to have maximum amount of time in the woods and minimal amount of time on the range. So what I want to do is form a new set of 300 blackout brass. I picked up a 16 inch Wilson barrel earlier this year that I've only put a few rounds through. And I've got a couple bullets that I really want to test. First is this 150 grain gold dot that is made specifically for 300 blackout. So I want to test with these and do some ballistic gel testing with them as well. So that'll be coming soon. And I'd also like to work up a load with these 110 grain Hornady V-Maxes, or Z-Maxes, they're the same thing, as a bit of a varmint load. And I also want to shoot these into some gel and see what expansion looks like at 300 blackout velocities. I can't remember. I may have already done that in the past, but it's been so long that I've forgotten. So I've got a couple of 300 blackout videos planned, but I need some brass. So that's what today's all about. So this right here is my Harbor Freight chop saw. And I bought one of these jigs off of Etsy. This one came from Elite 3D Designs. So this was the original, like that, or yeah, like that. Yeah, so that's what comes on it. You just remove this and then put this in its place. So right now I've got it set up to where the blade is about right there. We can adjust this a little bit because, well, let me show you what it does. So the brass goes in here and you notice that ball detent there. That is going to catch the rim of our case. So we push it in and it kind of clicks right into place and our brass is held in the perfect spot. And this one has this additional chunk on this side that keeps the part that was cut off from flying everywhere. Let's go ahead and cut this one. Okay, that went pretty easy. I could probably do with a fresh blade on this beast, but it's fine. And then once you cut that one, you can either push it right here or push the next one, you know, use the next one to push that one through. That's what our cut looks like. I would think a fresh blade would clean that up. Tell you what, let's go ahead and chop like two or three of them, and then we'll see if this length is about right. All right, this one's not wanting to push through. There it went. Yeah, I think this one just got a particularly big, nasty burr on it and didn't want to go through that little secondary piece. All right, first I'm going to knock these burrs off real quick. These burrs on the outside are a pain in the butt. All right, there we go. Not exactly straight, but not the worst. This is the first time I've ever owned one of these jigs. I usually just have done it by hand in the past, clamping them down in the standard one. It was a mess. So I'm used to very jagged, nasty cuts that are crooked. All right, those are cleaned up and looking about the same length. Let's see how long they are. First one's 1.285. Next one's 1.282. This seems short. Yeah, 1.22. I think this is way short. Let's go ahead and screw in a sizing die and form these real quick. I'm using my Redding full-length sizing die. I did a 300 blackout die shootout 100 years ago. I seem to remember this one came out of that test as my favorite. Can't remember for sure. I remember they all worked well in the end. All right. I'm going to lube these three up really well with Imperial sizing die wax. Once I get into production, I'll probably use lanolin. But here for these first couple, this seems easier. That's the wrong shell holder. That should be better. Still about the right place. Not gonna worry too much about exactly where the shoulder ends up. Just good contact with the ram, good enough for now. So up in there nice and easy, and then down and out. That is comically short. 1.280. Like 90 thousandths short. Okay, these three are junk. That was a waste. So what I need to do are loosen the two bolts from beneath and scoot this entire thing to the left. Like I said, right now it's about right there. I need it to be way over here by that. Maybe that's the way it was supposed to be. I mean, obviously. Obviously, I've got it wrong. All right, both of those are loose now. And the way this works, like it's, you know, there's a good amount of adjustment in all directions. So let's see, let's drop the blade. All right, let's see if I can get it tightened down without moving on me. Nope, already moved. Try and tighten it down enough to where I can still move it, but it's not easy. Yeah, that's better. Maybe if I leave the blade down, that'll help hold it in place. Okay, now it looks like it's about max length. Let's cut a couple more. Let's go with two this time. So that's still only 1.315. Let me clean it up and size it real quick. There we are, looking a whole lot closer to normal, but I think we're still going to be short. Yep, 1.323. What am I screwing up here? Well, here's another problem with this design. And it probably has to do, like I have the very old version of this chop saw and I'm not sure what's changed. Now I'm wondering if I change the tension on the ball detent, maybe that will change it. Maybe I should check their website. Let's try that. So they've got some pretty good instructions on their website. Looks like the ball detent is just to make sure you have enough spring pressure to capture the case and then eject it. So yeah, I'm just not seeing how I can make this work. And also from their instructions, I remember why mine is too far. I'm using discs that are way too big. I think these come with a little metal blade that's smaller. So that's what it's all about. All right, here I'm just going to chop this off. I don't really care. It's supposed to keep these things from flying everywhere. And I don't do enough of these to freak out too much about it. This thing's a bit of a pain in the butt to adjust. It's not the jig's fault, but it's a pain in the butt. All right, so now I'm going to cut about right there. I'm just going to cut through the plastic. All right, that smelled wonderful. All right, now I'm too long. That's good. Yeah, that cleaned up pretty well. Okay, I think that's a little bit shorter. Still a bit long, 1.422. Let's see what it is after sizing. All right, now we're looking like a piece of 300 blackouts. Now we're still quite a bit long, 1.430. I'm gonna trim one really quick with this little lee setup. Yeah, that's a huge pain in the butt. Taking off way too much. All right, let's adjust it shorter again. All right, this is it. I think I finally got it. These are coming out in the 1380s. A little bit wonky on my cuts there, right? Like I said, I think a lot of this just comes down to the blade. I've got a janky, incorrect blade. So that might clear up some of these problems. And I'm wondering if my clearance, because I ended up not needing as much as I cut off. If you can see the little bit of daylight there. You know, this I'm sure this jig is probably correct for the modern or current production chop saws. But like I said, I've had mine a long time. But whatever. So we're adjusted and locked down, and my brass is coming out, you know, in this 1380-ish range. So 1368 is the normal max length for 300 blackout. So this will give us a little bit of room to trim the case mouths, to trim them all nicely later on, I think. All right, let me size these two real quick. If the length changed, it wasn't much. So that one's 1386. And, you know, and plus they're not flat. So depending on where you measure it, you're going to get different numbers. Yep, that one in the 80s. And now I need to decide how to do this final trimming step. Because like I said, I had my lee set up out. I could also use my Frankfurt Arsenal case trim and prep center. But the problem is that these cases are so short that it's hard to get them in and out and handle them. And that's a really frustrating thing. So I think I'm going to try and set up my drill to use this for trimming. And then I'll use the case prep center for the case mouth prep. Yeah, that seems like a good idea. Tell you what, let's go ahead and take these two pieces all the way through. Or actually, I'm going to cut a couple more. We'll take five all the way through the process so I can get all of my equipment set up. All right, let's see what this lee trimmer comes out to. Yeah, that wasn't bad. That wasn't too annoying at all. All right, five pieces formed up and ready to load. This first piece is 1.358, which is the exact, you know, trim length. So that's 10 thousandths under the max length of 1.368. Next one's 1.359. Next one's 1.358. That one's 1.360. So this is good. This is right there where we were wanting it. And the numbers are pretty consistent. There's another 1.360. Good. So that's it. That's formed brass ready to load, right? I wonder if it fits in my gun. I should probably check that. No problem. No problem at all. Perfect. Now, one thing I can't remember from my testing in the past is whenever you fire this brass, so like right now we've got the length and everything just the way we want it. So whenever we fire form it, does that end up shortening the brass? I'm not sure. So I'll tell you what I want to do. I want to take these first five pieces all the way through. Let's load them, shoot them, and make sure that we end up with exactly the brass we're after before I go chopping up a bunch more really nice Lake City brass. Last time I was using this stuff, in a 223 video, somebody asked me where I got new Lake City brass, and it came from Mid-South Shooter Supply a couple years ago. They were selling these bags of 250, and I picked up several at the time because I was just kind of sick and tired of working with primer pocket crimps. So that's one thing I don't have to worry about today. I don't have to worry about removing the crimps from my primer pockets. All right, we'll see. Next step, I need to wipe off the little bit of lube I've got on these guys. And what I want to load in them is the 110 grain Hornady Z-Max, because I think I've got about 300 of these left. So I've got a few to play with. And the powder I want to use is Alliant Power Pro 300 MP. My old favorite for supersonic loads in 300 Blackout is Winchester 296 or Hodgson H110. Those are the same powder. But it looks like this 300 MP is going to be a really nice supersonic powder as well. And the Hornady manual has load data for the 110 grain VMAX, and Spear has got load data for the 150 grain. Oh, that's the wrong box. But yeah, you get the idea, the 150 grain gold dot. So I've got load data for both bullets with this powder, so I want to try it out. And we'll pick a generic load here in a few minutes. So I'm going to use CCI BR4 primers because I got a couple bricks laying around and I want to use them. Seems like I never use the BR4s. It's always the CCI 41 or the CCI 450. Okay, so for weighing our powder, I'm going to use the Lee Deluxe Perfect Powder Measure. So the Hornady data shows a max charge of 20.1 grains, and the Spear data for the gold dots shows 21.2. So I think I'm going to start off with 20. And we'll check these first couple, make sure we don't see any obvious signs of pressure or anything like that. Can't remember what I loaded last with this powder measure or what the charge weight was. It's got little CC markings here. I'm going to put it right at 1.0 CCs, which I could probably pull out the Lee lookup table and get an approximate CC number for this powder, but not a big deal. Oh, it helps to turn the flow of powder on. There we go. Now we're flowing powder. That came out okay. Said like 120 grains, and I'm like, what? Forgot to tear my scale. Let's try that again. 15.3. This powder measure is not very good at dumping into a pan. I'm going to dump into a case instead. Yep, that's 15.3. So let's take it out to 1.2 cc's and see what that gives us. 18.2, 18.3, okay, still not there. Okay, let's try that, 1.5 cc's. No, that's too far. Not quite looking for that sort of case fill. All right, I think this is going to be it at 1.2 cc's. These tenth of a cc increments are kind of big, so we might not be able to dial it in precisely. This first one's 20.1. This next one is 20.1. I've found this to be an extremely consistent powder measure with ball powders like this one. Yep, that's also 20.1. All right, I think we're good. The ladybug here might agree with us. So 20.1 grains, definitely a pretty good case fill. This 110 grain Z-Max is a flat base bullet, so should have plenty of room to get it seated in there without the loads being insanely compressed, hopefully. Let's find out. Let's see some bullets. All right, let's just use our standard Lee sizing or seating die. Run a case up in here and then screw the die down until I feel the crimp touch the case mouth. That's it right about there. And I'm going to back off about a turn and lock it down. The overall length in the Hornady manual is 2.050, so we'll just stick with that number. I think I barely touched the bullet. Yep, just barely. I'm going to go ahead down just a little bit more before I take my first measurement. 2.125, so I'm 75 thousandths long. That should be pretty close. 2.050. Next one, 2.051. Perfect. Right where we need to be. Okay, let's go shoot these five and we'll make sure we got the process correct. I think we're in good shape. It's a good looking round right there. Okay, so our brass looks fantastic. Looks like it, formed out well. That charge of our new 300 MP powder that we haven't used before doesn't seem to have gotten us into trouble. They all have a little ding in the case mouth, but nothing to freak out about. All right, so if the length on these looks good, then we should be good. 1.358, right at trim length. Next piece is the same. Next piece just a smidgen shorter. next piece just a smidgen short. And then last one looks okay. All right, so I think that's my process. So these five, yep, those five are fired and ready to go. Now I just need to do it 95 more times. So you've seen my different steps. I won't bore you with all of that. But once I'm done, tomorrow we'll get out on the range and we'll at least shoot a group or two with these 110 grain Z-Maxes, get a baseline velocity for this 20.1 grain charge weight, you know, all that good stuff. So the process was going so fast and smooth, I went ahead and loaded up the first 25 pieces that I've got ready, and I'm just going to shoot them now instead of waiting until tomorrow morning. I've got enough time for this, plus a nice evening hunt, get the video edited tonight, and then I've got all day tomorrow to hunt. Sounds like a good plan. All right, first step, let's get this scope zeroed, mainly so we can shoot a group, but also because, you know, just in case a deer walks by. I'd take a shot at a deer with these. Okay, here we go. Okay, that should be pretty close already. What was that first velocity? 2333. All right, I'll hide that shot and we'll shoot at the last dot here. We are shooting at 100 yards, by the way. Like I mentioned, this is a 16 inch Wilson Combat barrel with pistol gas and 1-in-7 twist, shooting through a Silencer Co. Omega suppressor. I want to put a couple more rounds in the gun. Let's go ahead and shoot a 5-shot group. See what it looks like. Okay, that didn't go off. I might need more gas. Actually, I just didn't have the magazine in there properly. You know, tap, rack, bang, and all that crap. Okay, things are not looking too good. About a 2-inch group so far. Well, let's just keep shooting. The worst part about this is that it's not even trying to group. Not at all. Well, 10 more. Okay, our 25 shot average was 2337 feet per second with standard deviation 19.5 and extreme spread of 64. And we got a 2.79 inch 24 shot group. Hey, at least we successfully fireformed the brass. So that's a successful range trip. All right, I'm gonna get packed up. I'm gonna go hunt for a couple hours and then we'll get back to the bench. So I finished getting everything loaded and I'll go out and do a couple mag dumps here over the next couple days, but our next 300 blackout video is definitely going to be the 150 grain spear gold dot, and hopefully we'll see a whole lot better groups than we saw today with the Z-Max and 300 MP. I don't know, we'll see. So by the time I got done, I was pretty happy with the jig for the chop saw. It did a really good job. I think where I had problems was because my blade was all messed up and my cuts were really jagged. There were times that they just didn't want to come through here, but I think with a cleaner cut, that auto ejecting system and all that would work a little bit better. I'm certainly happy with it. I just picked the one that Etsy recommended or said was the most popular. The most important thing, I think, the ball detent that holds the case while the cut is happening was perfect. The cases kind of snap into place. I always felt like it was where it needed to be. So overall, I'm pretty happy with it. They've been around for a long time now, and there's a lot of different little designs. So look around and see what's out there. I think that's it. No freaking deer this evening, but now I have all day tomorrow to hunt. So all right, that's it. Sorry this wasn't a more exciting video. Maybe next time. I'll see you then.